Let's welcome in our next guest, Mr. Ajay Bodke, CEO and Chief Portfolio Manager, PMS at Prabhudas Lilladher. Ajay, good morning. You know, you've been looking at the markets for really long. You know, if we look at the markets, as you know, what's happening vis-a-vis some of the other emerging markets, would the correct way to look at it would be that India is still underperforming the other emerging markets, so maybe there is still a catch-up role to play?
Well, I think India has benefited, you know, due to the torrent of liquidity that has moved into emerging markets. But I do take your point that we have relatively underperformed in the current surge that one has seen. But I also believe that the other markets were not as richly valued as the Indian markets when the rally began. And hence, I think I would say that it's a catch-up that those markets which were beaten down quite strongly vis-a-vis India, and that's why we are seeing them outperforming India in the short run. But I think the crucial event that all the eyes are focused on is the speech that Janet Yellen will be delivering tomorrow, and whether she gives a hint of any liftoff anytime soon, because the market currently is more or less sanguine that there will not be any increase in US interest rates till December. So if the speech were to be slightly hawkish in tone and give an indication that the strength in the US economy might prompt the US to lift off the rates earlier than that, then I think one could see a sort of turbulence in the emerging markets. And the torrent of liquidity, I think, could if not come to a halt, at least slow down significantly with money gravitating back towards developed markets. That's one issue that all of us needs to focus on. Because domestically, I think post-budget, I think four or five tailwinds that the market was expecting have already eventuated. To start with, I think the government adherence to fiscal deficit. Number two is the OROP announcement, the 7th Pay Commission announcement, as well as some of the long-pending legislations were cleared by the government, namely the GST bill and some other legislation, the bankruptcy bill. So I think all the positives, in my opinion, have gotten priced in, and the earnings season that that has just ended, I think it has been a story of contrasting halves. We have certain sections of the market. You take the home improvement companies, paint companies, cement companies, retail-focused private banks posting stellar numbers. But you have the other part of the market, the corporate-focused private banks, with the exception of Yes Bank and public sector banks, and some of the investment-led themes yet to show any traction. So I think we will need to wait for post-harvest October-November for the earnings season then, and see whether the volume growth that one is seeing in sectors like, say, cement or certain FMCG pockets gets complemented by a strong pricing power, which is still not evident out there. So a combination of the two, strong volume growth and strong pricing power, will then propel earnings growth, which in turn can then leave a room for the market again to start moving up. Because I don't see the incoming RBI governor having any leeway to cut interest rates anytime soon.
The point that you made about Janet Yellen, the speech tomorrow, of course, there would be some indication coming in from her speech. In the last few days, FII flows have slowed down, both on a gross buy basis and the net figure has looked largely flat. Do you think it could be because of that event risk? People would just wait for that event to get over?
Exactly. I think, it's a binary event, Pankaj. So if tomorrow, if the speech is dovish and no indication is given about any imminent liftoff, then I think one could again start seeing a surge of FII flows into emerging markets, India being no exception, and the markets again moving up. However, I think if an adverse event were to happen, then I think there is a scope for a goodish amount of correction in emerging markets, India being no exception.
Right. One of your top picks in the pharma pack is Aurobindo Pharma, and the second is Jubilant Life Sciences. Jubilant Life Sciences has got an approval, has seen a great re-rating, and Aurobindo Pharma, good set of numbers. Can you take us through these two calls?
Yeah. I think in case of Jubilant Life Sciences, one already has seen the first round of re-rating from 300 levels to around 520 levels. I believe that if one takes a slightly medium-term call, there is the radiopharmaceuticals business is the one that we need to focus on. there are around 7 or 8 opportunities that the company is looking at in radio pharmaceuticals with a total addressable market of $800 million. The primary among them is Rubifil, which the company is expecting to launch sometime in third quarter of the current financial year. Now, that is a product where the competition is very almost nil in the US markets, and the company is expecting a large amount of revenues to flow from Rubifil. Also, the launches that they have lined up in radiopharmaceuticals, I think in FY18 and FY19 also make us positive on the company. In case of, so we have a medium term, I would say a target price of around 600 to 650 with a 15 to 18 month perspective out there. In case of Aurobindo Pharmaceuticals, I think the numbers were a tad lower than or maybe in line with market expectations. But again, I think the large amount of ANDA approvals that the company has, I think is making market very positive. The company has said that sort of, you know, the EBITDA margins in the forthcoming two quarters will be higher than sort of, you know, what they were in the quarter gone by. And the company has given a positive guidance about the US markets business going forward. So I think Aurobindo, we have a target price of at least 950 to 1000 rupees in the, with a 12 month perspective. The third counter we are positive on in pharmaceuticals is Glenmark Pharmaceuticals.
Ajay, before we go to the next counter, just wanted to ask for Jubilant and Aurobindo. Despite the run up, there is a valuation comfort as well.
I think so, because as I said, I'm looking at a medium-term call between say 12 to 18 months kind of a call. I'm saying there are many launches sort of, you know, that have lined up, and let's not forget, Pankaj, that pharma as a sector has underperformed, I think, the consumption-led sectors. If you look at post-budget rally, then I think the rally has been more in case of all the consumption-led sectors, and pharma had lagged. So that's why I think some catch-up is also happening, and some money is gravitating out of some of these consumption-led sectors which have moved up in terms of valuations into the underperforming sectors, namely pharma.
Right. Let's talk about Glenmark as well. That's a company, which is not as attractive in terms of consensus valuations. But what are the triggers you're looking there?
Yeah, I think in case of Glenmark, there are three or four triggers. The first is there's a product called Zetia, where they have an exclusivity. It's a $2.6 billion drug, where whose launch from their end is expected to happen sometime in December of the current calendar year. I think in our estimate, the addressable top line that they could get from that product is between $200 to $300 million. And a large amount of that could flow down to bottom line. And that money the company, in our opinion, would be using to pare down the debt that the company has. Also, IFC Washington had subscribed to their convertible bond at a very marginal 2% rate of interest. So our belief is that that money also will be used by the company to pare down debt. So the balance sheet sort of, you know, repair process is on. The company, like many other pharma companies, had suffered due to sharp erosion in the currencies in CIS and Latin America, Venezuela in particular. But that episode is now behind us. The company has made provisions towards that end. And emerging markets, which were 35% of total top line, have progressively come down now to to mitigate the risk. The company has brought it down to around 25% and will further bring it down to around 17% of top line. So the focus will remain on US markets, India markets, and the API business for the company. So I think they are very strong in dermatology. 25 to 30 approvals, filings that they have done with US FDA. And the vendor consolidation process that has happened in America has led to all the generic prices coming under pressure. 8 to 10% drop in prices is expected for all the companies. But Derma is where the competitive intensity is less, where you only have Taro, Perrigo and Sun as the three main suppliers to the US market in the Derma part. And because the competitive intensity is low, I think the price erosion in case of Derma Therapeutic Group is also lower. And that's where sort of, you know, the company has a very strong product offering along with oncology and some of the NCE upside, which the market has sort of, you know, not been factoring in our view, also will come into play in FY18 and FY19. So I think there are multiple drivers for the stock, for the re-rating of the stock. And the company is, in our estimate, should have an ROE of around 26 to 27% over the next couple of years. So I think there, I think we are looking at a target price of 1200 rupees with a medium term perspective.
Right. I was just looking at your banking pitch. So it's HDFC Bank, it's Yes Bank, as well as it's IndusInd Bank. All the three are private names. None of them is at all cheap. So what would justify that? Do you think that that 20% growth rate would continue? We've spoken to a lot of strategists of late. They're slightly shifting more towards the PSU now, thinking that the worst is behind.
Yeah, I think insofar as PSU is concerned, I would still be slightly cautious. One has seen in the current quarter the deceleration in provisioning levels happening vis-a-vis the last couple of quarters. But I think that there's still a quarter or two of elevated provisioning that should continue in case of PSU bank space, as well as corporate focus other private banks like say ICICI and Axis Bank. So Yes Bank, if you look at the asset quality, it's pristine. Last few quarters, despite the RBI and AQR provisioning levels, there has not been much of a spike in absolute terms in case of Yes Bank. And the company continues to grow along quite nicely, between 20 and 25%. The NIM levels are stronger. So I think the premium in valuation that Yes Bank enjoys, say, over the other banks, in our opinion, is justified. Similar is the case with other retail-focused private banks, HDFC Bank and IndusInd Bank. I think 25 to 30% is the growth that we are penciling in. For IndusInd Bank, for HDFC Bank, between 20 and 25% we are penciling in. And the premium, in our opinion, will continue vis-a-vis the public sector banks, which are constrained insofar as capital is concerned, unless I think the government, like SBI, goes in for a large amount of consolidation. And there are four or five banks vis-a-vis 17 or 18 that today stand, which basically lack scale to compete. And there are constraints in terms of capital raising for them. SBI stands out as compared to other PSU banks, where we have upgraded the target price from 240 to 300, because we believe the bank has scale, the bank is adequately capitalized, and it has the wherewithal to compete on a strong footing with the private sector players.
Right. Can you just tell us that for most of these banks, is there a valuation discomfort, so you would want to wait for a correction, say if there is any to buy?
See, I think, in my opinion, the premium to the other public sector banks and corporate-focused private banks will continue as long as the growth impulses remain strong. And I think there are two or three pockets, sort of, if you look at the constraints that the public sector banks are facing or private corporate-focused private banks are facing. In our opinion, SME is one business or retail is other business. Now, these are two businesses where a large amount of, in our opinion, in the medium term, market share gains could accrue to the banks like HDFC Bank, IndusInd Bank, and even Yes Bank, especially the SME part. And that's why we believe that the premium should continue in these three banks.
Right. Let's talk about the technology pack. Now, that's a pack that has not been growing. You like Infosys, you like Hexaware. Is it purely because of valuation comfort versus the growth expectation?
Yeah. Now, in case of Infosys, one has seen post first quarter numbers, the prices coming up quite sharply. But we remain constructive on the strategy that Dr. Sikka has in place for growth in terms of moving the company towards automation, artificial intelligence, as a high-end consulting work. And I think we are keeping the faith with the strategy, and we believe that the downside looks very limited out here. Now, what applies to pharma also applies to IT. IT sector also has underperformed if you look at the rally that India has seen post March, and hence some tactical shift in terms of moving some money into IT also because of valuations being comfortable also will happen in our view in the short to medium term. And Infosys, I think, is attractively valued at the current price. Insofar as Hexaware is concerned, the company posted very strong June quarter numbers and has given a very strong guidance for September and December quarter also. The valuations are very attractive out there. And we have a target price of around 1400 rupees in case of Infosys in the medium term. And in case of Hexaware, we have a target price of 255 rupees in the short to medium term.
Right. The cement pack, ACC and Heidelberg, what's the call there? There, the rally has already started on, we've seen a good rally into these names.
Yeah. See, now cement is a sector which has posted very strong volume numbers in the last quarter. However, as I mentioned in the answer to the previous question, the pricing is still not there. And that improvement in performance that the cement companies have seen has primarily come through the cost savings, primarily the fuel cost savings. A lot of companies have moved away from coal to pet coke, and there are a lot of savings out there. Plus, they have saved on logistics costs, freight costs, and other sort of, you know, other manufacturing costs. Now, for a further re-rating in cement companies, the pricing power has to come back. Now, that's why the rural demand has to pick up. Now, that kicker will come in only post-harvest, October, November. That's why we remain constructive on cement. We believe that cement companies are still have a long way to go. And that's why the strong franchises like ACC and Heidelberg are the ones that we have picked up.
Right, Ajay, thank you so much for taking us through your top picks between different sectors like banks, pharma, as well as the cement pack.